Hello, everyone. Welcome to Grace Church. It's lovely to see you all. We're nice and warm in here at the Woodside with the sun blazing. In fact, let me just show you quickly. Give them a wave, everyone. There they all are. Brilliant. Brilliant. Okay. I feel suitably dizzy after that, but that's fine. Good to see you. We're here to worship the living God, who is, as we're learning in our sermon series on Exodus, the great I Am, who is unchanging, and who is holy and majestic and mighty. And as we're going to see next week, so, so gracious. He is our God, and he is with us in a very special way when we gather together, though he is with us all the time by his Holy Spirit. A special welcome to you if you are with us online and you're not usually with us. Really good to have you here. My name's John Hobbs. I'm the minister of the church. And if you're watching this after the service, welcome too. Do get in touch by emailing me at gracesussex@outlook.com. Why don't we have a moment's quiet just to prepare ourselves, a chance for you to pray your own prayer that the Lord would meet with you in song and prayer and reading and sermon. A chance perhaps to confess sin from the day so that you're coming before him rightly. A moment of quiet for you. I'm going to ask Charlie Burstow to come up, who's going to read a couple of verses from our reading today to help us think about these things.
With mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions. My people, the Israelites, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord, when I stretch out my hands against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it. Exodus 7, verse 4 to 5.
Brilliant. Charlie, you stay there. If you just move over that way a little bit so we're not too close together. You can see, Charlie, you can see me. I am bound in terrible chains, like the Israelites in Egypt. I can't move. I'm in slavery. And God says in that verse, doesn't he, with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites, and then everyone will know that I'm the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it. So I thought, Charlie Burstow has got a pretty mighty hand. So Charlie, can you break my chains? Really break them with your mighty axe. Oh, that's fantastic. Right, round of applause to Charlie. Thank you so much for such mighty breaking out. Well, have you left something behind? Here's your friend. There we are. There we are. Brilliant. Now, that is what God does for Israel in their slavery. Mighty acts that bring them out from under their oppressors. But can I tell you, that is what that same God does for us through the Lord Jesus. He releases us from slavery, to our tendency to do what's wrong, to our fear of death and the judgment to come. That frees us so that we might be free now to live his good and perfect way. And one day when he does bring right justice against all that's wrong, he will cast all that's evil out of this world so we will enjoy utter freedom and perfection in this world made new. Isn't that good news as we gather this afternoon? Well, look, let's bow our heads and I'm going to say a prayer for us. As we begin. Heavenly Father, true and just are your judgments. We praise you that you are a God who doesn't ignore wrongdoing, that you're moved with compassion to those who are oppressed by it. And one day, through your Son, the Lord Jesus, you will rid this world of all wrongdoing and bring about that perfect state we long for with all our hearts. Father, thank you too for your grace and your mercy. That means you're willing to forgive us through the Lord Jesus and accept so that we would be free from fear of that judgment and enjoy all the wonders of the world to come and of life with you now. And so as we meet this afternoon, whether at home or here in the Woodside, whether young or old, please meet with us. Reveal yourself to us. Reassure us of your mighty power and goodness. Humble us so that we might cling more firmly to Jesus, not relying on any sense in ourselves that we're worthy of your love, but only on your mercy. And as your redeemed people, equip us to worship you fittingly and joyfully as you deserve. Father, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to sing a song that I forgot we only had on a YouTube video rather than one done by our musicians, but we're going to sing it anyway. And it is O Lord My God, When I in Awesome Wonder, because it's such a wonderful song in bringing home the mighty power of God that's displayed in this creation, that same mighty power by which he showed himself the true creator in bringing judgment on Egypt so long ago. So let's stand, shall we, and sing O Lord My God, When I in Awesome Wonder.
Some wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ Christ shall come. With shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Do take your seats. And that refrain, then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to thee, is one that gives us assurance, doesn't it? That as we are faced with the mighty power of God, it does humble us. It does bring us low as we reflect on how readily we sin, whether it's in what we think or do or say. But then we sing, my Saviour God, and we're assured that in Jesus, He grants us forgiveness. So let's have a moment to call to mind our sins, shall we? And kids, this is one just for much for you as it is for us adults. It's a chance for you just to think back to this day or maybe this week and think, what are those things I know I need to ask God to forgive me for, say sorry for? It's really important we do that because it keeps us trusting Him for those things. So let's have a moment, just think, what is it? Remember, God loves, asks us to love Him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. How haven't you loved Him with your all? And then to love our neighbour as ourselves, that includes family members as well as neighbours and friends. How have you failed in that? Just draw it to mind. And then we're going to say some words together that will come up on the screen. And as we say these words, just think about them and make them your own, as a way of asking God's forgiveness. And so let's say together, most merciful Father, we confess before your awesome majesty that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We've sinned against you in our thoughts, words, and actions, through negligence, through weakness, and through our own deliberate fault. According to your great promises to us in Christ, forgive us and cleanse us. And for the sake of your pleasure and glory, renew us by your Holy Spirit, that we would hate what is wrong and love what is right, living a disciplined, humble, and godly life, rejoicing in you, our God. Amen. Well, let's continue in prayer. I'm going to say a prayer of thanksgiving, and then I'm going to lead us in our prayers for today, as it's my slot on the rota. So let's pray. Father, as we were here last week, and as we think on the Passover lamb, you've sent the Lord Jesus, your Son, to be the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And we give you such thanks that as we express a genuine sorrow for our sins, and we come to you yet again for your forgiveness, thank you that it is ours because Jesus paid our penalty, took our punishment all those years ago in his death on the cross, and have given us as a gift his right standing before you. So you see us as if we'd always done what is perfect and right in your sight. Gracious Father, thank you for the assurance that gives us. That gives us as adults, where we know we've been cold towards you and towards each other. Thank you for the reassurance that gives our kids here in knowing that you forgive them when they're sorry for all the tensions of family life, of all that's wrong. And Father, thank you that that means that we come to you now in prayer as forgiven children. And so we know that you listen to us and delight to hear us. And as your children, Lord, we bring home to you first our world. This week we've been reminded of the reality of war with the US strike on Iranian militias. We've been reminded of the suffering and hardship in the world, not just through the reality of COVID worldwide, but more tension in Hong Kong and in Myanmar. Father, we long for the coming return of the Lord Jesus, when all that is wrong with this world will finally be done away with. But until that day, we pray, O gracious God, that you would restrain wrongdoing. We pray that you give wisdom to governments and the determination through diplomacy to do something to bring a limit to wickedness and evil and poverty and hunger. Thank you, Father, for all these different charities that you have providentially brought about to bring good, even when those who work in them don't know you. Please use them for good too. But Father, we pray for Christians throughout the world, many of them actually in Iran, persecuted so hugely for their faith. Give them strong confidence in Christ, profound awareness of you being present with them in everything, and joyful hope, knowing that this life is just a short time before the everlasting glory to come. And help them, Lord, we pray, knowing those things, to be bold and wise in sharing the good saving news of the Lord Jesus to those who so need it. And Father, we pray for the UK as well, for our own government. Thank you, Lord, for all who serve in that way. Thank you that we don't have a more corrupt or less able government, as so many nations have. And we pray, Lord, for great wisdom for the government, and particularly for the cabinet, in handling COVID and helping us to return to normal as soon as is possible. Thank you, gracious Lord, for how quickly in our own nation vaccinations are being dispensed and people are being reassured. Father, we pray for the issues in Scotland. We pray where there has been injustice within government that it would come to light, that people would be brought to account. And we pray for the government in all four nations, that you would help them to look beyond COVID and to act and legislate increasingly in conformity with your will and your ways. Particularly that justice would be done, that those who are most needy would be cared for. We pray for the church as well. Father, we pray as we look through these coming months that you would refine your church through the struggle of this last year, bringing it to a greater depth of faith in you and appreciation of the fellowship you've brought about through Christ. Father, we pray that people would re-engage eagerly. We pray that you would help them to grow from learning lessons about themselves, just as you've revealed our own failings to us in lockdown. Father, so would you help us to bring those to you and find ourselves more patient, more persevering because of 2020. Father, fill us with a real joy in knowing what we have through Jesus. And we pray, Lord, as we come out of lockdown, that you would renew your church with a greater commitment to mission, to reaching out to those that are so in need of Christ, that our society might find that hope that can only be found in Christ of life to those who are dead. And Father, we pray for one another as well, Lord. We delight in being your church. We love each other as your people. And we bring before you Nicola and Agni. In their pregnancies, we rejoice, Lord, to know that you're knitting together these young ones in their wombs. And we pray, Father, for your protection on their health in these coming days. We continually pray for a job for Kevin. We pray for those unknown to us who are just struggling with all the pressures of these recent months. Lord, would you minister peace to their souls? Would you deepen their reliance on you? And Lord, we bring to you our children as well, going back to school. Father, we pray you would relieve any worry or anxiety in them, that they would see it as something to look forward to. We pray especially for years 11 and 13, with all the turmoil of exams cancelled. Father, reassure them you have their futures in your hand. We pray for year sixes, as they look to just a few months before moving on. Father, relieve their worries in the knowledge that what they go with you with them. And we pray for our teachers, Lord, please sustain them, help them with all the extra burdens they're having to face in ensuring safe environments for the children. Lord, we bring all these things to you. We bring our ministries to you for this coming week, for Christianity Explored and Kids at Four, for SALT, Parenting Matters, Think 360, and all these things, Lord, would you be honoured and glorified. For Jesus' sake, amen. Amen. Well, look, that brings us ably to some notices. Just very quickly, you've got them all on your email, but this week we don't have community groups in the evening because we've got Parenting Matters on Wednesday night. If you're new to the church, that's a yearly thing where we get together to think about what it is to be Christian parents. Please join us, not least because of the pressure that's been on us over recent months. It'd be lovely to pray together and be renewed in our commitment to being godly and Christian parents. Then next Monday, International Women's Day, the ladies are getting together on Zoom for social. Is there anything to say about that, Poppy, Bethan, that I can say here, or do you want to send something out otherwise? Okay. So if you haven't yet let Poppy know that you want to come, that's next Monday evening on Zoom. Please would you let her know through WhatsApp or text me and I can pass it on to her. Next Tuesday, the 9th, we've got for Sussex, Rico Tice, who presents Christianity Explored, doing a day of training on evangelism, how we share our faith. I'm really excited about that. He's an incredible communicator and it's going to be a fantastic day. You can come for the whole day on Tuesday on Zoom, or you can come for the morning or the afternoon. Can I really urge you to think about whether you've got the time for that? Kids will be back at school. So that might be a wonderful opening. We've got over 100 people already coming online for that. But if you would like to go to the Sussex Gospel Partnership website, book yourself in and let me know, or let me know and I can point you in the right direction. That's Tuesday the 9th. I think the next thing to mention is our new trainee minister or assistant minister and his wife. You can see a picture coming up here. We're announcing their names and places today because they're telling their church. So it's Tom and Gina Vaughan. He's been working in ministry at Exeter Baptist Church, and we're delighted that they're going to join us in September to work with us for the next 4 years. The young people already met Tom as he came on to SALT. They come to a place they've never been before, in an area of the country they know nothing about, but they're trusting the Lord, seeing that coming here will be something that they benefit from as well as benefiting us. What are they into? They love being outdoors. Tom is into tennis and running. He looks like the kind of guy, I think, for outdoor cross-country running. We'll see. Gina, she likes her outdoor stuff as well. She's doing a counselling course and she's a writer too, doing online writing and things like that. And she loves being involved in ministry. She did the job Dan did with students before he came here, the job I did. And I said to her in the interview, I did your job in exactly the same place in Plymouth. And she said, when was that? And I said, 1996. And she said, I was 1 year old. And I said, that makes me feel really old. But anyway, they're coming in September. So we're really looking forward to that. But we continue to pray for Dan and Chloe too, for them to find the best next thing for them. I think we're going to leave our notices there and we're going to sing again. And the song is, Our God is a Great Big God, because when we think about God in our readings today, that's what we'll be learning and we'll be thinking about. Now, I don't think we've got any Paul visibly in this one, so I'm going to have to do the actions, all right? Have I got a one of my kids that wants to do some, I've got his great big God actions with me? Ophelia will, brilliant. Here we go. Let's stand and we'll sing together.
Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. He's higher than a skyscraper, and He's deeper than a submarine. He's wider than the universe, and beyond my wildest dreams. And He's known me, and He's loved me, since before the world began. How wonderful to be a part of God's amazing plan. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. He's higher than a skyscraper, and He's deeper than a submarine. Wider than the universe, and beyond my wildest dreams. And He's known me, and He's loved me, since before the world began. How wonderful to be a part of God's amazing plan. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands.
Brilliant. Do you take your seats? What I love about kids' songs, they're such profound words. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. That is so encouraging. It's because He's big that we know we're secure. It's because He's big that we know that whatever He promises, He really is able to deliver it for us. Such a great phrase, if you can remember that. Our God is a great big God, and He holds us in His hands. Well, look, we're going to come to our Bible readings in a moment. And one thing we're wanting to say to folk as infection rates drop and people start drifting out of lockdown is that each week, if you feel that you want to come and join us at the Woodside, when you feel ready at home, do let me know. Do come and join us. We'd love to see more people here. But if you think until we can get Kids at Four going again that it's difficult with your younger ones, we would love you to come, even if at this point you decide you actually want to go home and watch the sermon online later on when it comes on there. It'd just be great to have you and your kids here for the first half, but do whatever is feeling right to you as the weeks progress. But if you are at home and you need to show your kids with something else to help them engage with the sermon, or you're here and you feel you need to take them outside, well, now's the time to do so. But I want to encourage you to give it a go of listening to the sermon. Even if you just pick up some main points, that's brilliant. And why not talk about them on the way home and try and embed them in your mind and heart as you do. You can even pray as you walk home if you're here for what you've learned. But before we get to our first reading, I'm just going to interview the reader a little bit. So Nicola, are you there online somewhere? Nicola Amifer?
Yeah, I'm here. Hello.
We can't see you yet, but Dan is going to sort it all out for us. There we are. Brilliant. Hello, Nicola. Great to see you. We can all see you in the Woodside. Now, we haven't seen you properly for quite a while, but something exciting is happening in 3 weeks, isn't it? What's happening in 3 weeks?
Yeah, in 3 weeks, we're going to be having another baby.
Whoa.
Another boy.
Exciting. So,
yeah.
And how has it been for you? Because, you know, you're there with... three boys already, which some here have got three boys and they know, you know, what that can mean. And you and Joelle both in work. So, you know, I imagine it's been quite hard. What have been the struggles, but what have been the encouragements over the last few months?
I think it has been quite hard. I think it's a really weird time with the fact that you can't really see anyone. And I don't know, just the general conversations that you kind of look forward to. You know, seeing people on a Sunday and just having like a nice encouraging chat, that kind of stuff. And it's kind of been a bit different. I think we're very thankful that the boys are all in school Monday to Thursday, so that really helped us out a lot. So I think that's something definitely to be grateful for, that they've got key worker faces and they've been going to school, which they've really been enjoying, because that's been really nice. And I think it's just been a struggle just with, not seeing anyone really. Kind of friendships you'd be developing, you probably wouldn't, haven't really developed as much. Like you say, people don't know you're pregnant just when you've got a headshot on the camera. So it's really weird having to tell everyone kind of thing, but it'd just be a natural thing, I suppose.
Well, look, Nicola, what can we be praying for you for these next 3 weeks? I know you've had a sense of prayers already being answered, haven't you, with pregnancy, but what can we be praying for you?
Yeah, I think for me, first of all, I just want to say I really appreciate everyone's prayers, and I think I know already that God has helped me so much through people's prayers, because when I was pregnant with Angelo, I had a very horrible pelvic condition that it basically meant that at the end, that your bones, well, at the end of my pregnancy, that I ended up in a wheelchair and I was in on crutches before that. And it was a really horrible condition where your bones kind of come out of place. So when you're just standing up or walking, your bones are just out and it's just agony. And I have to say, that would be enough to put anyone off, if I'm honest. But I'm very thankful, because they said to me at the time that in every subsequent pregnancy, this will be worse. You will have this condition worse and worse. And I'm so thankful to God that I have not one twinge this whole pregnancy. So I'm very grateful for everyone's prayers. So thank you very much. And yeah. I think going forward, I think really just for labour, I think, just I asked Aaron to pray for me the other day for labour, and he just prayed. He might pray it so simply, which I just thought, that's exactly what I needed to hear. He just prayed that that God would help mummy to bear with ease my baby brother. And I just thought, that's nailed it on the head.
Out of the mouths of babes. Yeah. I mean, we really want to acknowledge, I know that you and I spoke about your worries about the pregnancy earlier on. And you particularly said, please, could people pray, because this was such an awful thing. So we really want to acknowledge, don't we, that that is such an answer to prayer. It really is. Not everyone's known exactly what we were praying for. But what, you know, that is just incredible. And it's fantastic the Lord's looked after you in that way.
Yeah, God is so good.
Amazing. Well, look, I'm going to say a prayer for you, and then I'll hand over to you, and you're going to bring our reading, aren't you? So let's pray for a moment. Father, you are a God who hears our prayers, and we thank you, Lord, for the miracle of your care for Nicola, having been told that she was going to face this condition again, that you've kept her from it in this pregnancy. We praise you and thank you for your kindness for your children. And we do pray for her for these 3 weeks and for the labour. We pray, Lord, that it would all go smoothly, and this baby brother to the three boys would be born safe and well. I pray, Lord, that Nicola would have a deep sense of your fatherly care for her and your presence with her throughout, so that she would not fear. We pray for Joelle as well, that you would give him all the resources he needs to be a support to Nicola in these coming months and caring for the boys. And we pray for Aaron, Asher and Angelo too. Thank you so much for them. And we pray, Lord, that they would be wonderful sons looking after mum in these coming weeks, and looking after their little brother, and being the best they can be for the family's sake and because they love you. Please watch over this family and keep them. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Brilliant. Well, look, everyone, if you could turn to Revelation chapter 16, 1 to 11. Nicola is going to read that, and then Dan will come up and read our bit from Exodus and help us understand that a little bit.
So, Revelation chapter 16, verse 1 to 11. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, "Go, pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth." The first angel went and poured out his bowl on the land, and ugly and painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it turned into blood like that of a dead man. And every living thing in the sea died. The third angel poured out his bowl on the rivers and springs of water, and they became blood. Then I heard the angel in charge of the waters say, "You are just in these judgments, you who are and who were the Holy One, because you have so judged. For they have shed the blood of your saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink as they deserve." And I heard the author respond, "Yes, Lord God Almighty, true and just are your judgments." The fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and the sun was given power to scorch people with fire. They were seared by the intense heat, and they cursed the name of God who had control over these plagues, but they refused to repent and glorify him. The fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom was plunged into darkness. Men gnawed their tongues in agony and cursed the God of heaven because of their pain and their swords, but they refused to repent of what they had done.
Great. Thank you so much for reading that for us, Nicola. We're going to be looking at the plagues in the book of Exodus in case that New Testament reading slightly threw you. It's just a New Testament perspective on that. As we turn to Exodus chapter 6, verse 28, let me add my welcome to John's. My name's Dan. I'm the training minister here at the church. Hello to you in the Woodside, hello online, particularly if you're visiting us or if you are watching this after our service has finished. Now we're going to be covering four whole chapters of this book, quite a lot. We're going to focus on a small bit, but I'm going to read almost like an introductory trailer, and then we're going to pray, and then we're going to dig in. So Exodus chapter 6, starting at verse 28. "Now, when the Lord spoke to Moses in Egypt, he said to him, 'I am the Lord. Tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, everything I tell you.' But Moses said to the Lord, 'Since I speak with faltering lips, why would Pharaoh listen to me?' Then the Lord said to Moses, 'See, I have made you like God to Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron will be your prophet. You are to say everything I command you, and your brother Aaron is to tell Pharaoh to let the Israelites go out of his country. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my signs and wonders in Egypt, he will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it.' Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old and Aaron 83 when they spoke to Pharaoh. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, 'When Pharaoh says to you, perform a miracle, then say to Aaron, take your staff and throw it down before Pharaoh, and it will become a snake.' So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and did just as the Lord commanded. Aaron threw his staff down in front of Pharaoh and his officials, and it became a snake. Pharaoh then summoned the wise men and the sorcerers and the Egyptian magicians. They also did the same things by their secret arts. Each one threw down his staff and it became a snake. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. Yet Pharaoh's heart became hard and he would not listen to them, just as the Lord had said." Let me say a prayer for us as we begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, for all of it. Thank you for your mighty acts of judgment by which you saved your people. As we look now at them, please would it be your spirit who speaks. For those of us who are harboring sin, for those of us with hard hearts, please would we listen? Would we all be encouraged and know you more as a result of what we see here? For Christ's sake, amen. Well, as I said, we're going to be covering four whole chapters. Obviously, we're not going to get through all the detail unless you wanted to be here for the next 2 hours. And I don't think any of us want to do that with Zoom fatigue and sitting here. But because we're doing so much, I think it's helpful for us to have an image in our heads that describes what's going on. And I want you to think, kids, of a boxing match, okay? A boxing match, two opponents in opposite corners, and the prize is the people of Israel. Okay, so in one corner, we have Pharaoh. He is the king above all kings on earth. He has enslaved God's people. He has power, money. He has his whole religion. He is top and everyone knows him. And on the other hand, we have the Lord, the God of Israel, who is relatively unknown. Okay, Pharaoh is like, bang. Who is the Lord? In the trash talk that you get before every boxing match, Pharaoh has even said back in chapter 5, who is the Lord that I should obey him? I'm Pharaoh. Who is this God? In the middle of their world, and in the middle of our world today, as people disregard God, this is a question for his people. Who is the Lord? As Pharaoh tyrannizes God's people without consequences, it seems, as people in our society walk away from the Lord, as plagues afflict our world, it's the pertinent question. Who is the Lord that I should follow him? And in this fight, the plagues are actually God's fearsome answer to this question, who is the Lord? See, the Lord doesn't choose to reveal himself through a lecture or through a speech, but in Exodus 6, he says to his own people, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. Then you will know that I am the Lord. In chapter 7, what we've just seen, he says to Moses about the Egyptians, they will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt in mighty acts of judgment and bring my people out. See, it's uncomfortable as we go through these horrific plagues, but we need to see that the Lord is going to reveal himself as the Lord through judgment. More than any lecture could show, the plagues show us the utter futility, the foolishness, the destructive end in opposing the Lord. The plagues show us that the Lord alone is God, and that rejecting him as the sovereign over all of us is utterly foolish. As Pharaoh steps into the ring with Yahweh, the name of God, we're going to see how true this is. In our reading that we've just done, we get kind of like an exhibition bout. Moses and Aaron versus the magicians. Snake fighting. Aaron's staff becomes a snake, and yet it's matched by the trickery of Pharaoh's magicians. But it's a quick exhibition. Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. Outnumbered, it's an easy win for Yahweh. But look at the end. At the end of the exhibition bout, Pharaoh's heart became hard and he would not listen to them, just as the Lord has said. No, the exhibition was enough. Pharaoh wants to go toe to toe with the God of creation. And so we come to the main event. Now, the plagues we can look at as a boxing match of three rounds, because the nine plagues we're going to look at today split up quite nicely and deliberately into three sets. They're all structured in the same way. First, God says to Moses, go to Pharaoh early in the morning. Then in the next plague, go to Pharaoh. And then the next one, just the plague happens. The first three, Aaron starts them. The second three, Yahweh starts them. The third three, Moses starts them. three sets of three plagues, three rounds for God and Pharaoh to go at it. And in each round, there is a focus. Yahweh is going to do what any boxer who is confident of victory is going to do. He's going to show himself. He's going to show what he can do, what kind of fighter he is. So round one, ding, 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 let's go in. And kids, if you've got your hand out, this is one for you to fill out. The Lord wins every spiritual battle. The Lord wins every spiritual battle. The first three plagues are kind of like a warm-up for Yahweh. In mighty power, he turns the great Nile River to blood. He causes frogs to spring up and blight the land. And he mirrors the Scottish Highlands today by turning all of the dust of Egypt into biting gnats. But in this first round, the focus isn't even so much on the plagues, it's on Pharaoh's yes men, his magicians. In the plague of blood and the plague of frogs, it seems that they can match what Yahweh does. Look at verse 22. The Egyptian magician of chapter 7, the Egyptian magicians did the same thing by their secret arts. Again in chapter 8, verse 7. And in matching Yahweh, these magicians, these religious men of Egypt, give Pharaoh a sense of false confidence. Okay, we'll forget about the fact in chapter 7 about the plague of blood, Yahweh turns all the water into blood. And so for them to match him, Yahweh must have graciously allowed them just a little bit of water to practice on. Or the fact that they're producing more frogs, which I'm sure Pharaoh didn't want in chapter 8. They give Pharaoh a sense of false confidence. Now, kids, I wonder, when you are scared or worried, does anyone have one of these? It's just a simple blanket, but you know it's your blanket. When you are feeling like you need a confidence boost, you grab your safety blanket. You wrap it around you so that you can cope with whatever is going on around you in the world, if it's not very nice. You have your safety blanket. Well, if you like, these magicians are a bit like Pharaoh's spiritual safety blanket. They're making him feel safe, like he can fight against Yahweh. Like his gods can do what Yahweh does. But it is a false confidence. His heart becomes hard because he trusts in his men. If you look at, where is it, verse 22, the Egyptian magicians did the same things by their secret arts, and Pharaoh's heart became hard. The ESV says, so Pharaoh's heart became hard. He looks at his mighty spiritual men and goes, I can fight Yahweh. But by the time we get to the end of the round, look with me at chapter 8, verse 18, as gnats begin biting the skin of everyone in the land. When the magicians tried to produce gnats by their secret arts, they could not. It's only the end of round one, and Pharaoh's security blanket, his safety blanket, has been whipped off and thrown away. He couldn't even make it to the end of round one. The plagues haven't really even gotten serious yet. And yet whatever Pharaoh was placing his trust in spiritually, in his own religion, in his own power, in his own sophistication, wisdom, his yes men, is cast to the ground, showing that it can't match Yahweh. It's feeble opposition. The idea of a spiritual safety blanket is quite powerful because actually, many of us have them. The Bible calls them idols, false confidences in something that is not the Lord. They might not be magicians and Egyptian statues. In fact, I've guessed for many of us, it isn't. But for many of us, our idols are far more subtle than that. We can certainly make an idol of confidence about our own wisdom and knowledge and sophistication. We can certainly cling to money and power. We can certainly look for comfort in the things that those money and powers bring us. We can maybe even fool ourselves into thinking that it makes us spiritually better before the Lord. So many people build their entire lives on idols like this. And yet before Yahweh, how does it fare? How does your idol, your secret sin, your secret contingency, in case this Christianity thing doesn't work out, how does it do before the Lord and his power? Well, the Lord wins. The Lord wins. In the New Testament, we see that Christ has triumphed over every power by nailing their power to the cross. There can be no false hope before the Lord. Who is he? He is the only one. Any false hope cannot stand before him. If your hope is in anything other than Christ, his crucifixion, his resurrection, the power of God, well, if your hope is not there, then it will not stand before the Lord. So that's the end of round one, and we come to round two. And here we see that the Lord is the winner over his enemies for his people. Kids, I want you to fill in that word, enemies. And then you'll see I've got some boxes for you to draw. You can draw some big, lovely, juicy flies, some dead livestock, these cows and chickens and pigs, and then people covered in horrible, slimy spots. Because that's where, this is where the plagues start getting really serious. Now, the question for God's people in the middle of this, in the middle of a world of plagues and signs, might be, who is the Lord for us? Who is the Lord for us? And the answer to this comes in chapter 8, verses 22 and 23. Please look down with it at me. God says to Pharaoh, on that day that I bring a swarm of flies, I will deal differently with the land of Goshen, where my people live. No swarms of flies will be there, so that you know that you will know that I, the Lord, am in this land with my people. I will make a distinction between my people and your people. This sign will occur tomorrow. In the second round, with his security blanket whipped away, Pharaoh is brought face to face with the reality that God, Yahweh, is on the side of his people, his covenant people, whom he has promised himself to. So the Israelites have experienced the bloods and the frogs and the gnats. Maybe they needed a bit of a wake-up call to their God's power. But from this point on, it's all Egypt facing the judgment. The plagues suddenly become more than mere annoyances. They become deadly. Livestock dies. The last plague is festering boils, undoubtedly leading to infection, certainly pain, and it's all on the Egyptians. If you turn to the plague of boils, we get a final exclamation point that Pharaoh's security blanket is well and truly ripped up. His magicians can't even stand in front of Moses anymore. All this only happens, though, to Egypt. This is the God act. This is God acting in judgment against his enemies in order to redeem and save his people. The key word here is that the Lord makes a distinction. He is the Lord who is on the side of his covenant people. He is devoted to them. And that means the world is divided up into two types of people. It is divided up between God's covenant people and everyone else. And in judgment, God reveals himself now and in the future as for his people and against those who are not. This is hard for us to hear, but it is crystal clear in the Bible. We live in a world now, which our passage in Revelation alluded to, that is under judgment. now. We're not in Egypt, not in the middle of a boxing match between superpowers, but in our own day, plagues and afflictions impact both Christian and non-Christian alike, don't they? Typical of our age is pain and suffering. But for the Christian, with God on our side, we may experience pain, we may experience confusion and difficulty as a result of these things. But the amazing and very simple truth is that if God is your God, these are not a sign of condemnation for you. If you are a Christian, you are bought with the blood of Christ. And you may experience these as hardships. You may experience these as things which grow your faith, that are producing in you perseverance that leads to character, that leads to hope. You may even experience them as the Lord's loving discipline upon you. But they are not judgment. As a Christian, you are not judged now. It's amazing how two people can see the same event in different ways, because for the world, this is judgment. For the world, there is grieving without hope. Without the God who is there, there is no hope. We all experience tragedies as part of a fallen world. But for the Christian, we know God is on our side, that he is using all things for the good. For those who are not Christians, who are on Pharaoh's side, as it were, there is an entirely different perspective on tragedy. And that is judgment now, for judgment later. Because judgment is coming. Christ will return. Well, for the Christian, it's going to be a time of enormous delight. We see our Lord face to face. We know God is on the side of his people. We go, hallelujah, Christ, to take us to our promised land. But again, for those not in Christ, the return of Christ is the devastating collapse of all hope. Both groups are going to experience the same thing. Both groups are going to bow before Jesus when he returns. You won't be able to not to. But the experiences are going to be very, very different. Yahweh is on the side of his covenant people who are in Christ. And he will defeat his enemies now and forever. That brings us to our third round. And this round could be titled, "The Lord is the Winner in Every Battle for the Heart." The Lord is the winner in every battle for the heart. Kids, fill that in. We're covering a lot of ground, we're doing really well, but it might be that some of us need waking up. So I'm just gonna turn the microphone really high up. Sorry, Jess.
I can't hear everybody, can you hear me? Can you hear me online? Who turned the volume down? Are you listening?
If you put your fingers in your ears, if you turned your volume down, that's exactly what Pharaoh is doing throughout these plagues. These plagues are kind of like God turning up the volume. Listen! And yet Pharaoh sticks his fingers in his ears and hardens his heart and ignores. This is made so clear in chapter 9. Turn with me to chapter 9, the plague of hail. Kids, you can draw this. Massive rocks falling from the sky. Look at me with verse 13. Moses confronts Pharaoh in the middle of the plagues. This is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, says. Let my people go so that they may worship me. Or this time I will send the full force of my plagues against you and against your officials and your people, so that you may know that there is no one like me in all the earth. For by now, I could have stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with a plague that would have wiped you off the earth. but I have raised you up for this very purpose, that I might show my power and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. You still set yourself against my people and will not let them go. Pharaoh, you've seen that God is stronger than you. You've seen that he is not on your side. He's walking out of his corner in the third round of the boxing match, staggering, basically out on his feet. He hasn't landed so much as a tap back. You start asking, why don't you just throw in the towel? Why do you continue to set yourself up against Yahweh? Why ignore? And the answer is in verse 14. He has not come to realize that there is no one like the Lord in all the earth. Humanly, he's gathered so much around him that has hardened his heart that he cannot conceive that he would have to bow the knee to God. At the same time, God has hardened his heart that he might proclaim judgment against Pharaoh and show his power. A friend of mine describes this as one of the Bible's 200% truths. Pharaoh is completely accountable. Pharaoh is completely responsible. God is giving him the opportunity to respond. We've read up to this part, if you go through the text, Pharaoh has hardened his heart the first five times. He does it to himself. All of his human efforts, he will not repent. He will stick his fingers in his ear. He is 100% responsible. And yet at the same time, amazingly, mysteriously, the Lord is sovereign over Pharaoh's heart. The Lord is the one who controls the heart. And we hold those two things together. And yet, as we look through the text, if you read through it, you just sit there going, Pharaoh, why are you being such an idiot? And we know that he is responsible. He sets himself against the Lord and does not humble himself to see that there is no one like our God. The result is that Egypt is devastated. God graciously warns the people, if you don't want to get hit by flying rocks, stay inside. And yet verse 21, many ignore the gracious warning. Yeah, Pharaoh seems to repent. He says, I have sinned to Pharaoh, to Moses and Aaron. But as soon as God relents, he goes back on his word. He hardens his heart, showing he hasn't got it. He hasn't got who the Lord is. What's going to make Pharaoh listen? A plague of locusts, which devastate any remaining food that's left? No. Even his own officials come to Pharaoh and cry out, don't you realize you've ruined our country? Are you crazy? They're hoping that Pharaoh will see his own stupidity, but he carries on. What about darkness that forces you to sit still for 3 days? Will that make Pharaoh realize that he's not anywhere near God's level? Chapter 10, verse 3, will he finally decide to humble himself before the Lord? No. The Lord hardens his heart. In the battle for the heart, God wins. And the Bible warns that if we start on a path of rebellion against the Lord, well, eventually the Lord will give us what we ask for. To be in opposition against Yahweh, to persist in opposition against Yahweh, to hide secret sins, to keep Jesus at arm's length, is the height of foolishness, because Yahweh may well give us what we ask for. Our passage in Revelation, when the people did not repent and continued to curse God as plagues rained down on them, shows this is not limited to Pharaoh. In his pride facing the Lord, who is greater than any on the earth, Pharaoh do whatever it takes not to see who God is. Just as we come towards the end of our time, and well done for sticking with us, we're going to just going to look at two bright notes at the end of this, because I think we need that. Look with me at chapter 9, verse 20. There's a beautiful little hidden story in these chapters of Exodus around the Egyptians. Verse 20, those officials of Pharaoh who did fear the law, the word of the Lord, hurried to bring their slaves and their livestock inside. Amazingly, as God is pouring out wrath, as he's shouting at Egypt, there are people who are listening. They've seen that Yahweh is the Lord, who cannot be beaten, who is sovereign, who must be listened to. That he's on the side of his people, and they repent. Now, the lovely story is that when we get to chapter 12 next week and Israel leave Egypt, we get this lovely little note. A mixed multitude went out with them. I've got to assume that that is some of the slaves that the Egyptians had taken from other nations, and Egyptians who have recognized that the Lord is the Lord and want to follow him. There's grace here. As the Lord shouts at his world through his judgments, some people do listen. It's the same in the New Testament. After Jesus was crucified and Peter stands up at Pentecost and says to the Jews, "You killed Jesus, you cheered for his death, you did this." As they are cut to the heart and they realize they must repent, well, Peter says the way is open. Repent and believe, and you're in. You're Christ's. You're part of God's covenant people. See, in his judgment, Yahweh is still that kind of God, showing grace. And it might well be that in the midst of COVID, in the midst of natural disaster, in the midst of war, seeing how out of control we are, we say, wow, I need to get right with God. Wow, I need to follow the Lord, who is sovereign over all these things. And the way is open. And then finally, just a note for God's people specifically. Look at me in chapter 10, verses 1 and 2. Funnily enough, God tells Moses to put all of this on the Kids at Four teaching program. I have hardened Pharaoh's heart, the hearts of his officials, that I may perform these signs of mine among them, that you may tell your children and your grandchildren. That you would tell everyone in the covenant people of my power, my covenant faithfulness, my grace, and how utterly foolish it is to be opposed to me. That you may know, you my people may know forever that I am the Lord. It's going to be an ongoing battle for Israel's heart throughout the rest of the Bible. It's an ongoing battle for our hearts as well. Idols and unfaithfulness are ever present. But we remember this is our God, who acts in mighty judgment for the sake of his people. There's only one God, the Lord. And in the battle for our faithfulness, the Lord wants us to remember this. He wants us to turn to Christ. He wants us to repent in humility. For the first time, or for the 100th time, to turn to him and say, "You alone are the Lord." C.S. Lewis says that God whispers in our pleasures. He speaks in our conscience, but for us now, very relevantly, he shouts in our pains. It's his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Christian, do you need rousing to turn to the Lord by seeing his power, his might, and say, you know what, he is the only Lord that I will make king of my life? We repent in humility before him. And we repent in trust, persevering in a world under judgment now until wonderfully Christ comes in the future. Are we going to trust that when that question comes, who is the Lord, at the end of the fight with Pharaoh, are we going to trust that the answer is this? That Moses says in chapter 15, there is no one like our God. I'm going to give us a moment to sit in quiet, to reflect, maybe to think of how we need to repent before the Lord, how we need to fix his glory more in our minds. If you wouldn't call yourself a Christian and something that's been said here particularly impacts you, well, please sit in that for a while, think on that. I'd be delighted if you wanted to message me to ask any questions. But a moment of silence, I'll say a prayer and then I'll hand back to John. Our Lord, you are the sovereign over all the earth. You reveal yourself in mighty acts of power. You reveal yourself showing that no other idol, nothing at all, can compare with you. You show us that you are on the side of your people. You show us how utterly foolish it is to oppose you, to not repent to you. Father, please would you work in our hearts that this message would not be merely for today, but for our entire lives, that we would turn again and again and again to you, the Lord, for there is no one like you. We pray this for Christ's sake. Amen.
Thank you so much, Dan. And they should be sobering chapters, shouldn't they, in displaying God before us, but also encouraging ones that he is so mighty to save. He is our mighty judge. Our idols are powerless. And so we readily and eagerly humble ourselves and ensure we're on the side of the Lord and amongst his covenant people. We're going to sing by way of response. First, our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Reminds us that this God came to us in Jesus, and in Jesus will come again and will do away with all that stands against the perfection of his purposes. And then having sung that, we'll sing on to sing How Great You Are that celebrates God's greatness and goodness. Let's stand, shall we, at home or here behind our masks and sing.
Come on the cloud.
And so to the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Do take your seats here in the Woodside if you would. And that's it, folks at home. Though I had a text during the service to say that Luke, who usually hosts the getting together now at home, has been given a last minute offer of a vaccination, so he's rushed out for that, so that's really good news. But it does mean we need one of you at home to host, so I'm going to leave Dan perhaps to just who have we got there. Actually, Dan, can you just show me who we've got there? Stop recording. That would be good.